As you can see, we have a full agenda for you today that seeks to cover the who's, what's, why's, and how's of Eclipse Keeple, and hopefully will leave you with a greater understanding of Eclipse Keeple and its potential. Today's presentations are split into three main blocks. The first one borrows the usual title for beginner guides and covers the essentials of Eclipse Keeple. The second one goes into why CNA decided to develop Eclipse Keeple. Last but not least, we'll get to see how easy Keeple makes it to be a Calypso user, this both for existing and new users. I'll leave you now with Pierre Terret, project lead of Eclipse Keeple, who is the best person to present you this next part. Pierre? Pierre, you might be muted. You need to mute yourself.
Oui.
Okay.
Thank you, Paolo. I'm sorry. Well, I will present you the team with developing the Keeple project. So we.
We lost you again, Pierre. You must have touched the button.
Is it okay?
Yeah, it's okay now. I'll let you know if you do it again.
Okay, thank you. So we are currently 9 people to support the development of Keeple Java. Philippe Guillemin, who is a technical manager of CNA, follows the project. Ludovic Texera Costa is particularly invested in the documentation and on the design of the Keeple project website. Jean-Pierre Fortune is the main contributor of the Reader and Calypso API implementation. In fact, when I tried to change the slide, it switched to mute the micro, it seems. Sorry. Oh. Okay. André, Christea, and Olivier Delcroix have designed and implemented the remote plugin, the Keeple solution to operate remotely smart card readers. They have also made the Keeple demos based on distribute architecture. Mehdi Menzikov and also Youssef Amrani, who recently joined us, are focused on the mobile and embedded integration of Keeple. They work also on the Android and embedded plugins and on the related demo. And finally, Brice Ruppen is our DevOps. He manages all the continuous integration for the Keeple project. So, I will present you a short, shortly the architecture of Keeple. I'm sorry, it takes a time when I click one. Okay. So, the two main components of Keeple are the Keeple Core and the Keeple Calypso extension. The Keeple Core is a generic tool to integrate and operate smart card readers. And the Keeple Calypso is a high-level Calypso library to manage secure transactions with Calypso cards. On top of Keeple components, we could have a ticketing terminal application. And under the Keeple Core, plugins could be set in order to integrate smart card readers solution. The Keeple Core provides three interfaces. First, the Reader API for terminal application. Through it, terminal application could access to a specific reader and manage the card detection or the selection of application on a card. Secondly, the card API, this is the interface to manage the transition of the transmission, sorry, of APLU commands to the card and to get the corresponding responses. Finally, the plugin API is the interface to be implemented by the plugins. This interface factorizes lots of reader processing in order to reduce the effort to implement a plugin. The Calypso extension provides the Calypso API. It is a high-level interface to handle the card identification, the command generation, the card data recovery, and of course to operate the Calypso secure session and authenticate the cards. Next year, we plan also to provide another extension on top of the Keepel Calypso module. We will provide a Hoplink library. Okay. Ah, putain, c'est bon. Okay. As I said on the previous slide, the Keepel Core Card API is the interface to manage the APLU command transmission with card. So it is possible to develop a terminal application directly on the reader API, but with a library managing the specific processing of a card solution by providing high-level solution API, there is a possibility to completely hide for the terminal application, the generation of APLU commands and the parsing of APLU responses, and this is the case for the Keepel Calypso extension. The terminal application using the Calypso API no longer handle the APLU commands. So Keepel is a solution to develop a terminal application operating a smart card reader. For that, smart card reader solution are integrated with the Keepel Core through native reader plugins. If on the terminal the smart card reader is only managed by the Keepel Core, and if the terminal applications are only based on Keepel, it's perfect. But we could have the need to integrate Keepel-based terminal application on terminal which are already supporting non-Keepel-based terminal application. On a terminal with a smart card reader managing other kind of application. Okay. In this case, there is a reader manager who is already integrated with the other application, and this reader manager could be integrated to the Keepel Core through a dedicated plugin implemented using the same plugin API. In the same way than for a native reader plugin. So on a terminal, it is possible to mix non-Keepel-based terminal application with Keepel-based terminal application. We could imagine the case of a terminal already accepting payment cards, for example, with an EMV certified reader manager. And in case of PPSE selection failure, the terminal could pass the relay to a Keepel-based terminal application in order to do the processing of a Calypso card. Another example could be a ticketing terminal already operating a ticketing solution other than Calypso. It is common for ticketing system to accept a different kind of ticketing card solution. So in this case, an easy way to add the Calypso processing to an existing terminal could be to integrate Keeple. Well, about the integration of native reader solution, the Keeple project provides the plugin for the most standard reader solution. So we have already a PCSC plugin for Java and C++ environment. We also provide plugins in Kotlin for Android NFC reader and OMAPI solution. It isn't yet available, but we are looking to develop a Swift implementation of NFC reader plugin for iOS devices. Otherwise, CNA also has also implemented some plugins for some specific embedded reader solution. Those are for the moment not yet available in the Keeple project, but we are looking to integrate them. CNA has also implemented a dedicated plugin to manage the Calypso HSM solution. So using the dedicated plugin, a SAM instance on HSM could be operated using the same API as for a simple SAM module. And finally, in November, we will release a new version of remote plugin, the Keeple solution to operate remote smart card reader independently to the distributed architecture, whatever the network protocol. One of the biggest challenge to address in Keeple is the fact that we have to provide API for three kinds of development for the implementation of ticketing application, for the implementation of card solution, and for the development of plugin. Okay. So, as we have seen on the previous slide, the reader API, the card API, and the plugin API. Or provided by the core for these three kinds of development. A developer has to import explicitly a single Keeple module for the category of development. A developer has to import only for a specific category of development a single Keeple module. And then some other module could be automatically imported by transitivity. Now, I will shortly present you the two ways we have to manage a transaction with a card. And then Ludovic will show you how to build the first implementation of Keeple. So the first one is what we call the explicit selection. In this case, we start by defining the selection. Then we test the presence of the card. In case the card is present, we select the card. The card is identified, and next we can process the card application and release the card channel. The second way is the default selection. OK. In this case, the processing is not managed by a single entity. For example, in the case for the case where the card processing is driven by the insertion of a card in the reader, we have to integrate what we call an observable reader. In the same way, we start by defining the selection, but the main application of the terminal, which observes the reader, doesn't process directly the selection. The selection is set as a default selection on the observable reader. And then the observable reader starts the observation. It waits for the card insertion. When a card is present, is inserted, the card is selected, and the observer is notified about the selection. And in the same way as for the explicit selection, the next is the same. The card is identified, and the terminal can process the card application and at the end release the card. And when the card is released, the observable reader could repeat the loop and start the new detection of a card insertion. So now I will let Ludovic present you how to build a first implementation of Keeple.
Thank you, Pierre. So I show you how Keeple works. I present this with Jean-Pierre. So let's start it. I will show you how to quickly build your first Keeple application in Java, allowing you to read and authenticate a Calypso portable object. I will just show how to do it using a Redic to execute Java example present in the future version of Keeple.org. This application demonstrates Keeple's capabilities with the Keeple PCSC plugin. The example is configured to work with the card and SAM from the Calypso test kit provided by CNA. And for this SAM, you will need one PCSC contact reader for the SAM and another PCSC reader for the card, contact or contactless, depends on the card you use. So before showing you the demonstration, I will explain the code of the demonstration. So I show you the future Keeple website. So in this website, you can see the source code of the demonstration. So I will explain you rapidly how works Keeple. So the first step is to get and configure the readers. So it's easy. You just to register the plugin you want to use. In this case, the PCSC plugin. You get the reader with the name of the reader. You can configure the parameters of the reader. In my case, I configure is a contactless reader. And also I get the same the reader for the SAM. Eventually, I can configure the parameters. In my case, I don't need parameters. The second step is to create a SAM resource. The goal of the SAM resource is to create a resource to use during the Calypso transaction. So So first step is we prepare the selection of the SAM. In the example, is all the Calypso SAMs. We make the selection. We prepare the selection of the SAM. This part is to prepare the selection. And when the SAM in these steps, the SAM is present in the reader. Automatically, keeper process to split the selection at this step. And the second, for the next steps, we associate the Calypso SAM and the SAM reader to create the SAM resource using during the Calypso transaction. And before start the Calypso transaction, we also configure the security settings. It means the KVC we want to use, the key we want to use, all the security settings for the SAM to use during the transaction. This step is only to display basic information about the reader and the SAM. Now we prepare the Calypso PO selection. So we prepare Calypso PO selection. We configure the selection with an ID. We also choose to reject invalidate Calypso portable object. In this case, automatically, if keeper sees the card, and if the card is invalidated, the card is not used during the transaction. We add this selection to the selection process. Next, we verify the presence of the card in the reader. And when the card is present, we can start the processing of the Calypso portable object. So the first step we process is the first exchange, PO exchange. We process to the selection of the card. If the selection is okay, we can pass to the second exchange. Because if you have in Java, if you have an error, the Java application keeper make an exception. So it's why we don't see the exception here. All the exception is managed at the end of the source code. So when the card is selected, we can create a pre transaction. We provide the information about the reader, the PO reader, and the Calypso card selected, and also the security settings previously configured. Before process this exchange, we prepare all the command we want to send to the card. In this example, we only make a read record to read the environment file. We can also make another command. You can read the event log. You can read the counters. You only need to add other prepared commands. When all the commands are prepared, you can launch the first process to use is the process opening. It opens the session with the debit key. And in this step, keeper made all the transaction between the SAM and the PO. All this step is masked in the keeper. When the process is finished, I can get the information of the file. I can show the information of the file.
Ludovic, sorry to interrupt. We're getting questions, a request for you to zoom in a bit on the code. Anyway,
sorry.
The code is available, will be available on the website, so you'll get to see it pretty soon.
Sure. Oh yeah, don't.
Sorry, please go on.
It's okay. I think it's better for everyone.
Some of us wear glasses.
And at this same step, I can verify if the previous session, Calypso CQ session, is ratified or not. If you want to make a dedicated treatment in this case, you can add this step. And to finish, and to close the Calypso CQ session, in the example, we want to close the channel with the PO after the closing. So we prepare the release of the PO and process to the closing. We at these steps, all the command are sent to the PO and to the SAM to make the close secure session. And it's okay. The Calypso secure session end successfully. And the Calypso and the PO and the SAM are authenticated. So now we go to make the demonstration you in video. Sorry, everyone see the screen?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So we can start. In this video, I will show you how it works with Eclipse. It's easy. Just follow what the page on the Keeple website says. So you can see I create a Gradle project with the name project demo keeper. Secondly, in the build.gradle file, we add the dependency in order to import keeper component. So in the example, I use the snapshot because we to show you the last version of the of Keeple. We add the dependency for Keeple Java, Keeple Java Core, Keeple Java Calypso, and Keeple Java plugin PCC because we use the PCC plugin. We add also dependency for the logs if you want to see the more information. Now you refresh the Gradle to import the dependency. You can see all the dependencies are downloaded. Now we copy the source code of the application of the demonstration. So you need only to copy all the. And also, you create a properties files to have the logs, if you want to see the logs. Now all it's configured, so yeah, you can connect your PO, your Calypso card, and your SAM. So I connect the SAM in the reader. A first step, we launch the application in debug mode in order to configure the name of the reader. So put a breakpoint, you run the application in debug mode. And I go in the reader plugin variable to see the names of the reader. So you copy the name of the reader. In my case, it's the ASCII logo for the portable object. And for the SAM, is a identity cloud. So all is it's okay. You can now save your file and run the application. So I so in this case there is no card in the reader, so the section failed, and now we put the card on the reader and run again the transaction, and you can see all the transaction is successful. You can see all the information, the command sent to the SAM, to the reader, and the end you can see that the Calypso succession and successfully. Now it's finished for the first demonstration. So you can see it's easy to make your first application in it. Now the second demonstration is how you update your first Java application in order to use another Eclipse Keeper plugin. Another plugin is not so the it's easy to change. It doesn't affect the Calypso transaction. And this I will show how it works with the stub plugin. So I will show directly with the video. So it says in the first step, I hide the dependency for the Keeple Java plugin stub. We update, we refresh the dependency. You can see the stub plugin are downloaded. We import the stub plugin in the file. And then in the example, we only change to use the stub plugin for the PO reader. So we comment the configuration for the PO reader. And add the information for the stub plugin. For the stub plugin, it's more complex because we simulate the card. So you have to know if you want to change to another plugin, you only need to register the new plugin and get the reader. All the step here is to simulate the stub reader. And the two following steps is to simulate the card and the insertion of the card. So in the real plugin, you don't need to add these three steps. It's only for stub plugin. So for this, I have to add a file dedicated to the for the stub. So I add in the project the stub calypso classic file. Is the file contains all the the virtual information response of Socal. So now I build the project. And so I verify the sum is already is always in the reader. I can run the project. In this case, you can see all the transaction. It's okay, except it's the final step because in the example, we use a stub for the PO. And it's a real real card. It's a real sum in the sum for the sum. So you can see the session PO authentication failed on the sum side. So the second demonstration it's finished. Now we Jean-Pierre, we want to add
no I just wanted to say that that was the expected behavior to have an exception because we use a fake card and a real sum.
And the last demonstration is how to improve your first Java application to use the reader observability presented by Pierre. The target is to show how automatically starts the PO processing when the card is detected. And this example, the feature used is of the Keeple core is the Observer Reader features and the default selection notification feature. So before showing you the demonstration, I will explain the code of the demonstration. So in this case, I show directly in the Eclipse. So the code is the same. For these three demonstrations, the source code is the same for the Calypso part. So all the beginning of the code is the same. You configure the PO reader, you create your SAM resource. You prepare the Calypso PO selection. At this step, it change. You have to configure the observability of the reader. So we configure the observability to receive a notification all the time a card is a good or a card is presented to the reader. So is the configuration here and add the observability to the reader at this step.
Here we could have a more selective process and in order to have notification only if the presented card matches the selection, and it avoids to disturb the application with unwanted cards.
And yes, want to add something, Jean-Pierre?
No.
Okay. Then the observer is added, so we can wait for an event. In this case, when an event occurs, the method update is called. As dependent of the event, we made the transaction crypto transaction or not. So in case the S match, it means if the selection if the card is the good card is because in the selection we said to select a card with this ID and to reject an invalid PO. So if the card don't have this ID or it is invalid, we don't go in the same machine. We go in the other case. So if the card match, we can start the Calypso processing. So the first step is to retrieve the information about the card. So we retrieve the information. The section of the PO succeed. And all this step is the same as the previous demonstration. We create the peer transaction. We prepare a read record of the environment file. At the session opening, we process the opening. We get the information about the environment file. We prepare to release the PO channel and close the transaction. And and you can see the other case when other card is inserted, don't match with the configuration. You go in this step, and when the card is removed, because we use the observability of the reader, you are informed. In this case, you can make another process. So now, I show you the video. The video is I run only the. So in this example, the first time we don't present a card. So you can see the application is waiting. I present a Calypso Lite card. This card don't have the ID, so you can don't match. And when I present a Calypso Prime with the good ID, all the transactions succeed. And when I remove the card, the application is waiting for another card. So it's finished to my part. So now I let Philippe Guillaume to present why we decide to go to.
Don't get my job away from me, please. So thank you for the presentation. Thank you also Pierre and Jean-Pierre for this overview and introduction to how things work with Eclipse Keeple. We got to see the architecture, some code, and how to make quick examples that show how it all works. And it really works. Okay, it's video because we were afraid of the usual demo bugs and blue screens that we don't control, but it actually works. As you can see, the team has worked really hard into making Eclipse Keeple as simple to integrate and use as it can be. Before moving on, just a quick reminder that you can post any questions you may have in the chat box. In the spirit of openness that joins us today, everyone will be able to see everyone else's question. So please don't be shy. So now, yes, I'll pass to Philippe Guillaume, who will give us further insight into the whys with the next section. Philippe, please.
Thank you, Paolo. Between the two technical sections, we would like to back to the reason why we had decided to choose. Okay, remote connection. Do you see the screen correctly or no?
Yeah, I think we see it before you, Philippe. So just have patience and believe.
Okay. We try to explain to you why we have chosen the open source to use our open source project to for Keepl, and I'm sorry. Okay. Yeah. It's a delay between the time I click and the time the slide appears. Sorry. So just a few words about to remember what is Calypso. I'm sure that a lot of you know about that, but we mainly focus on the local transaction. That is to say, Calypso is a secure communication protocol used between a portable object and a reader. It's not a complete teleticketing system. It's we guarantee that the transaction is secure, is fast, and use a contactless technology. And to promote this technology, this is the role of CNA. I try to. Do you see the following slide or no?
Not yet. No.
Oh, it's too far. Sorry.
Yeah. Wait. Okay.
So this is. Sorry, this is a delay between the time I click and the time the slide appears on my screen. Maybe okay, Ludovic suggests me he will change the slide. It will be better, and we avoid this issue. Okay, so Calypso Networks Association, its characteristic is to be driven by transport operators and transport authorities, and since its creation, CNA has promoted standards. And especially for the contactless cards. And the main objective of this promotion of standards and the use of standards at all the level of the solution was to foster competition between suppliers of solution for transport operator and also to facilitate interoperability and openness. I could say that especially for cards, it has been a success because today Calypso can offer a full range of smart card based on the solution provided by multiple card supplier. You can see their name on the slide. They are well known smart card provider. And also, it is based on a chip provider. You can also see like NXP, STMicroelectronic, and Infineon. Can you give the next one? Yes, thank you. So the question is, why openness? In fact. To guarantee an actual competition between suppliers throughout the life of a teleticketing system, it's necessary that the transport networks control their teleticketing system. And if we have been able to open the offer in terms of cards, I show you on the previous slide, it's much more complicated at the level of the equipment and especially validators, sales machine control tools, because the software is completely linked to the hardware most of the time. Most of the time, you have a solution based on embedded software, where the tools provided, the tools for the development of the application is provided by the software supplier, the hardware supplier, sorry. In fact, even if large transport networks have broken this dependency by imposing their own APIs on a hardware manufacturer, they succeed in doing that because they have strong technical teams. And when they publish a tender, they ask to the candidate who will deliver them the hardware to provide the API they have defined. And what we wanted to do with Keepel was to standardize this approach and offer this kind of solution to every member of CNA, even small and medium transport network. But even large transport networks may have an interest to use Keepel because I say to you, they succeed in doing that because they have certainly strong technical teams to manage this. And for them to maintain this competence, this keen knowledge about Calypso is not really their core business. So I think they also have a great interest to move to Keepel to benefit from a up-to-date, optimized Calypso solution. And as Pierre explained to you previously. So next slide, please. So the first reason was for our members to help them to control the system. But beyond the transport networks, ticketing must adapt to the new mobilities. Everybody have heard about the acronym MAS, Mobility as a Service. We need absolutely to pronounce it in a presentation on transport to be serious. So it's done now. But we can give an example. Consider a transit card that allows to rent a bike, use a car park after to take a public transport with a special fare because you use the same support. In fact, radio contactless and NFC technology are highly efficient to answer some problems of flow, security, reliability. But most of the time, they are complicated to build, and especially if you have a proprietary system. So our goal was to offer an open, flexible, and scalable solution at a low price, because most of the mobility services like bike sharing, car rental, car park, are made by small private company or company who have no interest in investing in Calypso technology. So we wanted to offer a quick solution to use at least the authentication of Calypso, because if you look at the bike sharing system, most of the time it's an online system. That is to say, you just need to authenticate, and on the central server, you have the right for the service. But you have to really authenticate, not just read a number on a card that can be cloned. So the idea was to offer the real authentication provided by Calypso Card, with the security needed for this kind of service, but in an easy way. You don't need to invest in the Calypso cryptographies with the exchange between the SAM and the reader and the card, So it was our second goal. It was really to facilitate the adoption of Calypso by new mobilities, often provided by small company. And in any case, it was not their core business to invest in the Calypso technology. So, next slide, please. So the question after is, why open source? In fact, at first, it is important to understand that it is not the distribution of the source code that makes a program open source. What makes a program open source is the right included in a license to use, modify, and redistribute it freely. And most of our members are subject to public call for tenders. And if we wanted the explicit mention people in their tenders, the character, the open source character, must be unattackable. And especially, we have to give the same access condition for all the candidates to this tender. And in particular, without restrictions due to intellectual property. So this is why CNA became a member of Eclipse Foundation. And in the following part of this webinar, I will ask to Frédéric Desbiens, who is a program manager, to explain what is the role of the Eclipse Foundation in an open source project. So let us a few seconds to transfer the presentation. Frédéric, if you want to share your screen.
Yeah, I tried it. Normally you should see it soon, hopefully.
Yeah, thank you. It's okay for me. I stop.
You see it? All right. Excellent. Well, thank you so much, Philippe, and thank you to the Calypso Networks Association for this opportunity. So as Philippe mentioned, I'm Frédéric Desbiens, or Fred. I'm the program manager for IoT and Edge Computing at the Eclipse Foundation, and it is my privilege to work with the Keeple team in the context of our IoT working group. So what I will be trying to explain first is how important open source is, generally speaking, even in a business perspective. And I was, you know, searching for a good example to use, and I stumbled on this one. The fact that, you know, the industrial process for beer has been discovered by accident by ancient Egyptians, you know, a few thousand years before Christ. And, you know, can you imagine a world where the industrial secrets to make beer would have been, you know, a closed secret, you know, something that wouldn't have been shared among human beings? What's great about beer and what's great about wine and about many, many things in humanity is the fact that, you know, you have so much diversity and variety from all over the world. You know, great French beers, Belgian beers, etc., and the same for wine and the same for many things. And this leads us to the conclusion that openness, the fact that a specific industrial process, or in the case of software, a specific code base is open, creates ecosystems. And, you know, ecosystems have much more value than a single project or a single community can have. And ultimately, you know, I think that's an important realization. And that's something that the Calypso Networks Association has understood very well in joining the Eclipse Foundation. Now, what are we? You know, what kind of ecosystem, open source ecosystem are we? We like to qualify ourselves at the Eclipse Foundation as the community for open innovation and collaboration. So this is all about openness, in the sense that every project that we have is open source, and every project that we have is community driven, okay? So the Keeple project, like all of the other projects at the Eclipse Foundation, is a little meritocracy, and it's owned by its developers. So there's a Keeple project lead, and there are Keeple committers, and those are the people driving, you know, driving the project forward. So the staff for the foundation doesn't intervene in projects. Typically, we're there to support them and provide services and that kind of stuff. And that's really important, community-driven. Then we are code first. I mean, we have specifications and we believe in architectures and blueprints and stuff like that. But essentially, the way we see the world is through code first and foremost, okay? So typically what will happen is that we will accept new projects and we'll try to build.
We lost your screen.
You lost my screen. Okay, yes. Let me share again. Oh. Thank you for letting me know.
Sorry to interrupt. It's still...
No, no, I'm totally glad that you raised this. So do you see it now?
Yeah, it's back now.
Thank you so much. We are coders because we try to build, you know, a community around real code that people actually use in real world systems. And that's really important. And then the third characteristic that we have is that we are highly commercial friendly. Open source doesn't mean that you can't build a business around it. In fact, many of our members do that, whether it is industry consortia like the Calypso Networks Association or commercial players like Bosch and Siemens, or, you know, we have startups working in open source with us. We have large organizations, but essentially everything we do is commercial friendly, and we encourage our members to have commercial offerings on the top of our core open source projects. Taking a step back now, you could say, hey, I don't need the Eclipse Foundation to open source anything. I can just create a repository on GitHub and make my source available there, and that's it. Yeah, but when we do that, essentially what you're doing is to try to create an ecosystem of your own. And that's a lot of effort. You know, you need first, you know, there are more than 10 million repositories on GitHub right now. How will you make sure that yours can be seen by your potential users? And then the thing is, in order to create an ecosystem and a community around the project, you must demonstrate that this project, you know, will continue to be developed and will be accessible to everyone, and that there will be a level playing field among all the contributors on the project. So if you're the single vendor, you know, managing this project, it's much harder to do that, and people will be suspicious about you because they will think maybe you have ulterior motives. And you look at the market, I mean, that's a reality you see. I mean, even Google, there's a clear difference in, let's say, Kubernetes as an open source project versus the Go language as an open source project. Kubernetes is now the property of the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, the CNCF. So it's vendor neutral, it's managed through a foundation, etc. Whereas Golang is a property of Google. And Google can at any time shut down requests for features and stuff like that and go in any direction that they want. But the problem with that is that obviously you may have a successful single vendor open source project, but you're not really building an ecosystem. In our case, we feel that we offer more value because not only we have a thriving dev community and high quality code, but we offer a variety of services and guidance to our projects in order for them to thrive. So if you're not familiar with the Eclipse Foundation, we are now close to 400 projects. Maybe you heard about us because of the Eclipse IDE. That's just one of the more than 375 projects we have at the Eclipse Foundation. And those projects are incredibly healthy and thriving. Our membership is close now to 400 organizations. And, you know, it's a who's who of large and small organizations in the space. But looking a bit more closely at what we do in IoT, we have an IoT-specific working group where the Calypso Networks Association is a member. And we have, at this point in time, 46 organizations. And once again, some of them are very small, like Alloxy, a Belgian startup, or Cedalo, a German startup. And, you know, and then you see Huawei and IBM and Intel and all the large ones. But really, this is the place where we try to drive IoT innovation at the Eclipse Foundation. Taking a step back, the Eclipse Foundation is not just about IoT and Edge, but IoT and Edge is certainly one of the four strategic focus areas that we have. And you see the other focus areas on the slide, and you see the kind of services that we offer. So we'll dig a bit through this right now. So our four strategic areas are complement each other. I mean, we started in development tools with the IDE that I mentioned, and it's got you know, 6 million active users, so it's very much alive. But we are working on the next generation of browser-based tools through our cloud development tools working group, and that's an important part of our business. We have 5 very healthy automotive working groups, and now Daimler has joined the Eclipse Foundation as a strategic member to support those automotive working groups in driving the vision there. And the two important cloud-native Java. So we are the home to Jakarta EE, the successor to Java Enterprise Edition. But really, IoT and Edge is one of our 4 pillars. And obviously, Keeple is an important project, a very strategic project that we have in our IoT working group. Looking at the services that we offer, you know, there are 4 broad categories there: governance and processes, ecosystem development, IP management, which is a distinctive feature of the Eclipse Foundation. Not every foundation does that, and infrastructure. So governance and processes. We have a well-defined development process, the Eclipse development process, and Keeple has been developed for many years now under that process. It's a bit cumbersome at first, but once you get the hang of it, it provides stability and predictability in the development process. We offer, as I mentioned, a vendor-neutral governance structure. So we ensure that there's a level playing field among all contributors on every of our projects. And that's important because when you open source something at the Eclipse Foundation, this becomes really a project that's owned by the community, not, you know, the initial contributor. Our project lifecycle is well defined, and all technical decisions are made by project leadership. So my role as the program manager is not to make decisions for the Keeple project. Those guys know their stuff, as you have seen with the earlier presentations. And my role is just to help them, not dictate their direction. Which means that we create really at the foundation an open innovation environment, you know, at industrial scale. And this means that, yes, there's a collaboration layer in the middle where even competitors come together to work on the open source projects. But then there's a competition layer where many commercial adopters can just run with the code and build commercial solutions around it. And what we provide is the bottom layer, the governance layer, once again, where we provide this vendor-neutral environment to enable collaboration. And up to now, we estimate that all the shared investment that our members did since 2004 when we started produced more than $13 billion of shared value. We also provide some infrastructure, and that's important here because when you start a project at the Eclipse Foundation, then you will host your code on our infrastructure. There are many options there, but the newest option that's not mentioned in the slide is now we have a GitLab environment in Switzerland. So if you are an EU-based organization and you are a bit unsure about what's happening in the US, we have you covered with servers that are physically hosted in Europe. We also do IP management and licensing. So when you contribute code to the Eclipse Foundation, we check the licenses, we check the third-party dependencies, all of that to ensure that, you know, when we make this project available, people can download it with confidence that there won't be IP problems with it. And this is something we do on an ongoing basis for our existing projects as well. And we take care of the trademarks and that kind of stuff as well. So this is another value-added service that we offer so that our projects really can focus on the code and not on the IP management, licensing, and complexities around that. So we have you covered in that department. And finally, ecosystem development and marketing. We do a lot of that. And in fact, that's most of my job. So it's my job to get out in the field, speak to people about the great projects that we have, and find new adopters for them and even new contributors to them. And it's certainly something that I enjoy very much. So overall, when you consider everything that we do, the projects and working groups that we have are just one component of this ecosystem where we also exchange and build new business models and ultimately create value together as a community. So my call to you, if you're not already, please become a founder member of the Eclipse Foundation and join our working groups. And specifically in this case, I think Eclipse IoT would be a good place for you to look at. And we invite you to participate in open collaboration and innovation with us. So you can have a look if you want to learn more at our website or connect with our membership team at membership@eclipse.org. And thank you for listening to me this morning, or this afternoon in your case.
Thank you, Frederic. Thank you, Philippe. I'll let Ludovic put the presentation back again. And while that's just to focus a bit on the advantages that Eclipse Keepl brings for providers. We talk a lot about operators and authorities, and sometimes it's good to focus also on the part of the providers, because today this is meant to be for developers. So for new actors in the Calypso world, the value of Eclipse Keepl is simple. It's rather obvious. It removes a lot of obstacles and makes it easier for new entities to provide Calypso-based solutions. For existing providers, Eclipse Keepl helps structure solutions and make them easier to evolve. We've all of us that participate in the Calypso ecosystem have seen the struggle that it is to ensure that a product or solution can keep up with the constant evolutions that are required for Calypso products. And we at CNA hope to be able to help providers in that regard by supplying the base building blocks for any Calypso-based solution with Keepl. Providers are then free to build on top of Eclipse Keepl their own added value components, which provides a level of differentiation between each provider. And this freedom comes in a very big part from the assurance brought by the Eclipse Foundation in terms of the IP of those building blocks, so that all providers are completely comfortable in using these building blocks. And next, Pierre Terry is back with a view of the advanced features that Keepl offers to Calypso users. Pierre?
Thank you, Paolo. Well, I will present you three advanced features of Keepl. Can you hear me? It's okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Okay, so I will present you three advanced features of Keepl. The first one is the integration of observable reader solution. Next, I will present you the remote plugin. And finally, I will show you the automatic processing managed by the Calypso transaction API. I'm trying to... about the observable reader solution, all observable reader solution provide a way to be notified when a card is inserted. But to correctly chain successive transaction on the terminals, it could be necessary to be also notified when a card is removed. Unfortunately, not all observable reader solutions have the capability to detect the card removal. So, to manage this issue, I'm waiting for the slide. So to manage this issue, the observable reader has three internal states. In fact, we request to manage the removal detection only when the card processing is finished. So in case an observable reader solution doesn't have the capability to detect the card removal, when the card processing is finished, the Keepl API will, if necessary, will ping the card using a low-level APLU command. So, in this way, we are able to integrate any kind of observable reader solution in an optimal way. We have seen how a smart card reader solution is locally integrated and operated in in standalone by a terminal application. In this case, the ticketing intelligence is in the standalone terminal application. With the remote plugin, Keeple proposes the possibility to manage a reader in a distributed architecture using the same API. In this case, the ticketing intelligence could be managed on a remote terminal, and which is integrated with the remote plugin, and the a virtual reader, a kind of virtual reader instance, is created for to communicate with the with a native reader of the remote terminal, and using the same API, the master application has the capability to operate to operate a remote native reader. Ah, I'm sorry. C'est quoi ce truc? And I have an issue with the slide. I'm looking for the previous one. Okay, and we can have a kind of hybrid mode. For example, a terminal could manage in standalone a reader and switch to a state where the in a driven mode. And in this case, the coming the next operation are managed by another terminal. I can give you an example. For example, if we have a mobile vending machine which has the capability to read in standalone the content of the card, but if this vending terminal has no SAM module, it could ask to, a remote sales server to manage the reloading of the card. For the remote plugin, we provide seven kind of setting to manage a distributed architecture. We are able to support the case where the reader is on the network client or also on the server side. And we have specificity in case the reader on the network client is observable. In case the reader is on server side, we are able to manage the case where the reader is observable or not. And we are also able to manage the observation of the plugin. For example, if we have a server with a pool of reader with some module, in case a new reader is a hot plug to the server, the new reader could be detected, the embedded SAM also, and automatically the resource is available for the server processing. And we have also a specific mode for what we call pool plugin. it is used by this interface is used to manage HSM. So with a remote plugin, we are able to interface Calypso HSM on the server. Now I will present you all the automatic all the processing which are automatically done using the Calypso transaction API. Here in the middle, you have the command issued by the ticketing application to the Calypso transaction API, and all the other arrows will show you what happened, what operation are managed by the Calypso transaction API. So it's just an example of transaction to show the capability of the API. So in this example, I start a transaction by preparing some read some read of file. The read operation are combined with the card selection. So you will see that at the end, any kind of transaction could be managed by only setting three requests to a card reader and three requests also to a SAM reader. So I prepare the read of the record, I prepare the section, and when we call, in fact, we have two kinds of method in the Calypso transaction API. We have prepare method to prepare a request, and we have process method to transmit the request. So when the section is prepared, I process an explicit selection with the card reader, and then the Calypso transaction API transmits the request to a Peru reader. So in this request, there is a list of API command. The card channel is open. The card is selected. And so some IPDU, some read IPDU command are operated outside of a secure session. Ah. I'm sorry, I have an issue with the click of the mouse. I want to click only once. Okay. So after the last APDU response, the card reader will provide all the card responses to the Calypso API. The Calypso API identified the type of card, its serial, its revision, all the supported features. It could also check automatically if the card is blacklisted, or in case the Calypso card is a HEE implementation, it will also check the validity of the serial token, and the Calypso API reply to the terminal application a card image, and to recover the data read in the card, the terminal application has just to request the card image to recover the two files which have been read at the selection. So it was the first. The card selection is the first request to the card reader. Now, in a second request, we will open a secure session and read some data inside the session. So the transaction is initialized with the card reader and SAM reader. It is initialized to control to manage the secure session in an atomic way. Some other read commands are prepared, and we ask to open a secure session for a specific key. In this case, the Calypso API will first request the SAM reader to get the SAM challenge of the secure session. So the diversifier is set on the SAM, and the SAM reader get back the SAM challenge. The Calypso API next use the SAM challenge to configure the open secure session IPD command to transmit to the card. And in a single request, the open secure command and the read command are sent to the card reader. So it is the second request to the card reader. And in a single response, all the APW response are returned to the Calypso API. In this example, I read the environment file at the selection, but here I asked to read it again inside the secure session. So, in order to authenticate the data of the environment file, the Calypso API checks the consistency of the card response. So, it will control if there is an attack based on injection command. It will check if the card image is consistent. So if I have already read the environment file at the selection, the value should be the same inside the session. So the terminal application doesn't have to make the verification. The Calypso API also memorize in cache all the exchange with the card. This command are not sent for the moment to the SAM to update the MAC of the session. The Calypso API also check the rectification status and will issue an exception to the terminal application in case the card is not ratified. And finally, the Calypso API confirm that the second card request has been correctly processed. The terminal application could check the content of the new file read in the session by asking the Calypso image, because the Calypso image has been updated each time there is a read or access or read or write access to the Calypso card. And for the last exchange, we will play a modification command. We will prepare the update of a file, the decrease of a counter, and we will ask to release the card channel. To transmit the request, in this case, we do a process closing at a not ratified state. to limit the exchange with the SAM, the Calypso API will determine if there is a capability to anticipate the future card response. If it is the case, the Calypso API will determine the response of the update record command of the decrease counter command, and will send to the SAM reader all the APD command, all the card command made at the beginning of the transaction, and the new command which haven't already be transmitted to the card. So all the commands of the secure session are transmitted to the SAM module in a single request. So it is a second request to the SAM reader. The SAM reader will update the MAC. Will transmit all the data to the SAM in order that the SAM will be able to compute the MAC of all the session. And finally, the SAM provides the SAM certificate of the secure session. The Calypso API gets the SAM certificate and prepare the closed secure session for the Calypso card. The update command and decrease counter command are sent to the card, and with the closed secure session command with embedding the SAM certificate. So the Calypso card will provide the status for the modification command, and will provide also the card certificate. There is a mistake. the Calypso API check if the responses of the APD command are the same to the anticipated responses, and then the Calypso API transmit to the SAM reader the card certificate in order to authenticate the card on the terminal side. And in case the card is successfully authenticated, the Calypso API confirm the success to the terminal application. So during this transaction, we have made only three requests to the card reader and three requests to the SAM reader, and most of the processing have been generated by the Calypso API, and the Calypso API provide a simple way for the terminal application to build the secure transaction. It's okay for me. It was the last advanced feature of Keeple.
Thank you, Pierre, for those features and that detailed view of a remote transaction, showing the many optimizations that Eclipse Keeple provides in order to ensure that the number of exchanges between client and server are optimized. This is used for both offline and online transactions to ensure that performance is high when using Eclipse Keepl. So we have still a bit of time for questions, but we don't have any questions. So unless anybody wants to ask a quick question and type it on the chat. No? Well, I guess we'll end early. So that's all we have for you today. I want to thank you all for your presence, and I hope you've enjoyed this brief glimpse into the deep worlds of Eclipse Keepl. I want to give also one last thank you as well to all the speakers that brought us all of these presentations today. This is a project that is not meant to exist in a void, and we saw that clearly in Frederick's presentation. We hope you will join us in creating a vibrant and active community for Eclipse Keepl and to make sure that it answers to the needs of the developers, making it an always evolving project. The team is always at your disposal for any further clarification, and you have the contact right there. So from my part, until next time, I bid you adieu.
There is a question.
There was a question while I...
Okay. The Calypso API is a high level API, so which is independent to the Calypso revision. So currently most of the features of the Calypso revision 3.1 and 2.4 are supported. We haven't yet tested all the support of the revision 1, but we will do it soon. And we still have to integrate the features of the revision 3.2 and 3.3.
So, if this time there are no further questions, I'll wait it a bit. There we go. We have another question. What are the main differences in the new remote plugin?
Just a word. It's because we use the old remote plugin with slave API and master API, and I'd like to know if there are differences in the new version of the remote plugin.
Maybe Andre could provide a nice response.
Hello, I'm Andrei. Yes, James. for the new remote plugin, all the API has changed.
Okay.
In scope to simplify the integration by user application. In the new version, it will be possible, easy, to integrate network protocol like HTTP client server or as WebSocket, for example. And the new integration will, the new Keepl Remote plugin propose very simple interfaces with some method, not a lot, in order to remote the execution, to execute the remote services, and the integration, the layer, the network layer is at the charge of the user, but it's very simple because the user needs only to implement some method, some interfaces provided by the new API. And the notion of slave and master disappear. There is only the scope, in fact, is to hide completely the remote processing by proposing a plugin like a native plugin in which the application, the user application, can register it as a native plugin. And for the user application, if it's remote, all is hidden because the application processes exactly the same algorithm if he has a native reader connected to the terminal or if he is executed from a remote terminal.
Okay.
I can show you, if you want, a diagram of the of the
if
new.
If you have, yes.
Yes.
And I think the other question will be if we upgrade to the last version of Keeper, can we still use the previous version of remote plugin, or do we have to migrate to the new version of remote plugin?
You have to migrate. Old plugin will be remote.
Okay, you have to migrate both Keeper Core and Keeper Remote plugin.
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you.
I will show my screen.
It's showing now, Andre.
Yes, it's okay.
Yeah.
Oh, in the Keeper.org, in the new website, it will be a section specific to the remote ticketing application, and all is under construction actually. But all the documentation will be stated here, with the different notions of the remote architecture. In this, I will show you a diagram. No, it's not this. Sorry, it's this. And that's why we will see the difference. I will reduce a little. In this diagram, the network layer is not shown because it's independent. The development of the network layer is independent of the ticketing application. We will see. We see in this second diagram only the API required for the ticketing application. At the left, we have the card reader. All this block, the yellow block, is the client app on the RSS project, is the client app, which has a direct access to the card reader. And on the right side, there is a remote application installed on the server. to start the process, there is a need to initialize. On the server side, we will register the new remote server plugin using a specific factory. And this registering is like we register a PCSC plugin, for example. But because this application is remote and do not have access to a local reader, he needs only to register a remote plugin. And that's all for the initialization. Client side, there is the same thing. The client side, we need to initialize a service provided by the remote plugin using a different library, but only a service, and to register his local plugin with the local reader as now. The initialization is very simple. After that, in this example, the client app will start a process. In this example, this use case, he prepared directly a selection that he operated through the Observer Reader like a standard app, standalone application. And in this example, we have a result. This result, after that, the user, the client app, can execute a remote services because he wants that to delegate the ticketing service to the server. And the client had only to execute, to call a single method with all parameters. The parameters are the server ID. It's a string to indicate that will permit to the server to identify which service need to be executed, the materialization, validation, for example. During this call, it's possible to transmit the content of the cat, which was previously get by the selection, the matching SSL. And it's also possible to send to the server application, to the ticketing application on server, some user input data as an object, a user object, and the server can access to this object to do some if it needed. It's not required, but it's possible. And this call of this remote method is synchronous. That's why at this point, the client is blocked on this method until he received a response. And when his response is received, all the process was terminating. And what's happened during this call, only using this method, the server will create a virtual reader, will notify the remote ticketing application that there is something to do. The remote ticketing application access to the virtual reader, get the service ID, and which with this service ID can start a specific ticketing services like a materialization validation, and he can get access to the matching SSL which was previously read from the card, and for the user input data which was transmitted by the client. And after that, the remote application will operate a Calypso transaction directly using the virtual reader, and all of action processed on the virtual reader will be transmitted directly to the card through the network implementation, which was transparent for the client application, and that's all. When all the process was terminated, then the server will indicate it, can prepare some user output data to transmit to the client as a response for the call of execute remote service, and indicate to the virtual plugin that we want to terminate the service. In this case, there are many possibilities, but in this case, the virtual reader is generally removed and the process ends.
Okay.
In fact, this integration is very simple because there is only need to call a single method, and Calypso transaction or transaction will be operated as it was connected directly to the native reader, and it is possible for the transport layer to use synchronous or asynchronous protocol, and for to configure the network configuration, there are many possible. The user has only to implement some interfaces. Here is an example of the interfaces to implement in case of a synchronous protocol as an HTTP client server. The Keeper Remote plugin proposes some elements, the node, and the user has only in HTTP communication to implement a user client sender and server side as a controller. And the user client sender need only to implement the API, the interface Keeper client sync. That's all. And this interface only expose a single method, send request, which have an object, and the responsibility of the user to transmit this object to the server controller. The server controller can access using a utility method exposed by the remote test plugin, the node, the server node, and transmit code on request on the server node, and await for the response and retransmit, send the response to the client, and that's all. And it's finished. And this part is completely abstract. It's independent from the intelligence of the application of the ticketing application.
Andre, we're running out of time, so I'll have you to interrupt you a bit here. Maybe it's a good idea to have a dedicated webinar for the remote mode, because it's naturally complex, but Andre and Olivier managed to make it much simpler than it should be. So it is something that should be seen. And I think that we could stay hours and hours discussing the detailed configurations. So it also gives me the opportunity to thank all of the team as well that has been involved in the development of Keepo. Even if most of them didn't get to speak today, it was their work that allowed us to be where we are today and presenting you all of this. As you can see from Andre's explanation, the team is passionate about their work, and they're just delighted to be able to share and to be able to talk to everybody about what they've been doing. So I think we've covered all of the questions that's been placed in the chat. As you've seen, a new website will be available during the month of November. Pierre says beginning with the COVID and everything, we always try to give some more latitude. And hopefully we'll get to be together in another webinar about Keepo in the near future. So goodbye, everybody.
Okay.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye. You.